call to order the regular meeting of the Hamilton County Board of County Commissioners. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Here.
Mr. Bankston?
Here.
Mr. Boyd?
Here.
Mr. Jeter?
Here.
Dr. Mackey?
Here.
Mr. Martin?
Here.
Mr. Sharp?
Here.
Mr. Smedley?
Here.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Here. I have the prayer and the pledge this week, and we're glad to have Fred Bennett, the director of the Titus International, with us today. Mr. Bennett, you greet us, please.
I will. Thank you so much for maintaining this time-honored tradition and for your service to the county and to the citizens of this county. We appreciate it a lot. The most important relationship in this room today is between each individual person and an eternal God who loves you very much. I can't top the words of many of David's prayers, so I usually try to quote David, but he gives one sentence in Psalm 15, and when he does, God responds to him, and that's what prayer is. It's two-way communication. So please think about this with me. He prayed, "Lord, who may abide in your tabernacle? Who may dwell in your holy hill?" And God's answer to him are these words: "He who walks uprightly and works righteousness and speaks the truth in his heart, he who does not backbite with his tongue, nor does evil to his neighbor, nor does he take up a reproach against his friend, in whose eyes a vile person is despised, but he honors those who fear the Lord. He who swears an oath to his own hurt and does not change," in other words, he keeps his oaths, God says this is an honorable man, a man who will someday dwell with him. "He who does not put out his money at usury, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent." This is the word of the Lord. Shall we pray? Father, thank you for answering when we speak to you. A simple question. We know that salvation, dwelling with you forever, is by grace through faith. But you describe very clearly the kind of person that people of faith need to be. Those words are clear and they're unchanging. Lord, may every person in here who is a person of faith, a relationship with you, be this kind of person, Lord, including me first, as you spoke to me this morning. And then may anyone in here who has no relationship with you come to find out that it is simply by faith, through grace, that they can receive this relationship and dwell with you forever. Bless the people in this room today as they conduct honorable business for your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Face the flag and render the proper salute. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The first item on our agenda today, we have a presentation by Mark Gravett. Mr. Gravett.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and commissioners. I hope everyone had a Merry Christmas, and hopefully we'll have a prosperous New Year. What I wanted to do is in my previous position, we had presentations once a year to where the different commissioners of the departments came and gave us an update on their respective departments, and that's what I'm here for today. Some of the things that I want to go over, keep in mind that the facts and figures that I present to you are calendar year figures. They are not fiscal year numbers, okay? Since completing my first year in the Register's office and with the year end of 2019, I wanted to provide you all with an update of the Register's office. The Registers, just to give you a little bit of history, Registers of Deeds is a position established by the state constitution brought over from English law as the official record keeper of all legal documents either required or allowed by law to be filed or recorded in our office. While most of these documents pertain to real estate in some form, be it the multiple different types of deeds, assignments, leases, deeds of trust, and etc., we are also responsible for recorded financial documents such as UCC financing statements, amendments, and assignments. To the miscellaneous documents such as powers of attorney, liens, judgments, depositions, military DD-214s, and etc., In total, we are responsible for recording and maintaining an index for currently 98 different types of documents in our office. Last year, in calendar year 2019, we saw over 6.9% increase in recordings to 62,259 document packets. That's up from 58,000. That screen right there that you're looking at shows you some of the different, just a very small snippet of the types of documents that we record. One area of considerable growth were e-files. For those of you that aren't familiar, e-files are electronic recording documents, which title companies, law firms, lenders, they are progressing towards with technology. There are some that are still doing traditional paper documents, but in our office in the calendar year 2019, we had an astonishing 41% increase with over 20,000 document packets recorded, up from over 14,000. As I said, we do still have some that bring in paper documents, but that is progressing towards e-filing. As you all know, Hamilton County's real estate market continues to increase, and yet it's again confirmed by the types, not necessarily the types, but the amount and quantities of documents that are filed in our office. Some of these numbers are really big, so if your eyes tend to glaze over, believe me, I completely understand. For calendar year 2019, the total reported conveyance amount for Hamilton County sales was $3,057,859,210. That was an increase of just under 14% from the year, from calendar year 2018. The Tennessee conveyance tax, that is a tax, it and the deed of trust tax, or mortgage tax as it's referred to sometimes. Our office is constitutionally mandated to collect that and remit it to Nashville. The conveyance tax, we saw an increase of just over 13%, and that was collected to the tune of $11,212,857, and that was up just over 13%. The deed of trust, or some people refer to as mortgage tax, that those words are synonymous with each other. Deed of trust, mortgage. The state of Tennessee is a deed of trust state. The state of Georgia is a mortgage state. So it's pretty much the same thing. In 2019, we saw an increase of just over 28% in this tax, where we collected $4,331,098,962. So those two figures for a total of just over 17% of $16 million. I'm forgetting my clicker. For calendar year 2019, totals the Tennessee state taxes and fees, we collected just over 17% increase to $16,121,859 in state transfer taxes and fees. We remitted to the state of Tennessee Department of Revenue $15,734,934, leaving our office with a minuscule $386,925. So for those of you that heard, that were at the presentation, the legislative breakfast, that's why I am passionate about trying to get the Register's commission raised to 5%. We took, for the state, we took in over $16 million, but in return, we only received $386,000. I don't think that's a fair and equitable partnership, for lack of a better term. A couple other numbers here. In just the past 14 days for the year of 2019, I don't have a slide for this. I decided to throw this in there this morning in this presentation. Just in the past 14 years of 2019, we recorded over $94 million in transactions and over $177 million in mortgages just in 14 days. And then finally, for the calendar year of 2019, that's how much we remitted back into the Hamilton County General Fund, $1,237,262. Again, those are calendar year figures. I wish government would switch to calendar year rather than fiscal year. Maybe the chairman could explain why, because I, being an accountant, because I sure don't know why. Everyone else seems to go on calendar year, but government seems to go on fiscal year. So with that, and I didn't mean to put you on the spot, Mr. Chairman. I just thought I'd throw that out there, but
I'll get that changed, Mr. Rabbit.
Okay. But anyway, I hope that gives you everyone a little more insight into what our office does. We are responsible by the Tennessee Department of Revenue. We are agents for them on collecting their fees and remitting them to the state.
I do have a question. This always intrigues me, so let me ask this question. Calendar year 2019, surplus fees remitted back to the county,
yes.
$1,237,000. Does that mean that's over and above the money you got to operate your office, so you turn that back in?
That's after salaries and expenses, yes, sir.
So let me ask, if you turn $1.2 million back in, what can we look forward to when you present your budget this year? Will your budget be roughly what it was presented last year, or will you take into account that you turned back in $1.2 million? So, because that's quite a bit of money. Now, if
yes.
somebody comes up and says, hey, I mean, you know, we had a few thousand, a few hundred thousand that we turned back in, that's easy kind of. $1.2 million is a lot of money. So I guess I'm just curious, if you turn back in $1.2 million, will that be taken into consideration when you bring us a budget this year and say, you know, I turned back in $1.2 million last year, so my budget's not going to be quite as high this year? Or will we get the same budget for that you got last year? Will you do your same budget and not take this into consideration?
No, I do not take this number into consideration. I work my budget on the needs of trying to forecast the needs of the office.
Mm-hmm.
In this next budget, I'm trying to get to the point with our older records, similar to what juvenile court clerk did, Gary Baylor. Mm-hmm. In terms of scanning and digitizing all of our older documents. So that's going to be a huge part of my budget this year. Now, I don't really want to get into all the specifics, but my plan is to take that out of the DP budget, data processing budget,
mm-hmm.
Which is a user fee similar to what I did for the furniture in the office a few months back. So that will not have any direct impact on my operating budget.
Mm-hmm.
Those are two different budgets we're dealing
right.
with. So that's a long statement to a short answer of no, I'm not going to take that into consideration.
Okay. And I guess it intrigues me, and I ought to ask our finance people this, but if we got all of these offices throughout county government saying, I turned back in $1 million. Turning back millions and millions of dollars. When budget time comes, why is that never taken into consideration that, guys, y'all are budgeting $1 million more than and you're turning this money all back in? Al, can you?
Yes, sir.
I'm sure you can explain.
We've already budgeted for that in revenue. It's called excess fees.
Uh-huh. So they do a budget, and then you budget for them turning money back in?
Yes. The excess fee, you'll see the excess fee budget, I think, it's around $15 million. I could be wrong there. I'm shooting from the hip. But we anticipate what they're going to turn back in, and we budgeted it this way for years, so it's already included in the budget.
Yeah, I not to interrupt, Mr. Kaiser, but, yeah, I do have to try to forecast what my future surplus revenue is going to be. And just to be clear to the public and to the media that is here, these fees that my office charges are controlled by the state. They are not controlled by my office. They're not mm-hmm. controlled by you guys, okay? These are the vast majority of these fees are in Tennessee code.
Okay. One more question, Al. So the way you said y'all handle that right now, what you're assuming and telling us through the budget is, hey, these budgets are turned in, but we're estimating across the board, if you add them all up, I guess is what you're doing, across the board, we're estimating that through all of these offices, there'll be about $15 million they'll turn back in.
That's exactly right, and we've got a historical trend that goes back years.
Yes.
To prove that, and then so we budget it every year. And don't hold me to that 15 million.
No, I'm shooting from the hip on that.
But
yes.
But it's a large number.
And that's just is that just from the constitutional offices?
Yes, sir.
That's made up.
Those that have excess fees, not all of them have enough revenue to have excess fees and turn them back in. The criminal court clerk would be one of them.
Okay. That comes up short usually.
Yes.
Over.
Yes.
Okay. It just seemed kind of odd to me that any office would continue year to year to year to budget over what they use and then say, okay, we turn back. It sounds good. You know, it sounds good. Hey, I turn back in fees this year. I turn back in fees. But looks like sooner or later. I mean, I know in my past history of submitting budgets and stuff, I mean, I wouldn't get a high budget one year if the year before I turned back in money and kept turning back in money. I mean, when I'd present a budget, they'd say, hey, you didn't use this money last year, and they'd expect. But apparently our government works a little different.
Yes, sir.
In that area. Okay.
Well, Mr. Chairman, if I may, it's not always based upon what we budget for.
Mm-hmm.
It's also based upon, you know, external factors, you know, like such as last year, we had almost record amounts of real estate transactions come through our office. So, you know, it also deals with, like I said, external factors that decide on how much money that we have in surplus as well. So,
yeah. And I can see a little bit how your office would be. I mean, like you said, it, I guess, depends a lot on the real estate market, how it goes up or down, and I can see how yours would be more fluctuating than some of the other ones, but I was just, we learned something today. I learned something today. So let me see. I don't have any other lights on. Does anybody have any other questions for Mr. Gravitt? I don't see any other lights. Thank you for coming and presenting.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay, we have before us quite a few minutes of the recess meeting, December the 11th, the agenda session, December the 11th, the regular meeting, December the 18th, recess meeting, December the 26th, the recess meeting, December the 31st, and the recess meeting, January the 2nd.
Move for approval.
Second.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Baker, a second by Commissioner Smedley. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd? Mr. Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Mr. Clerk, I've got two reports. Will you enter those into the record, please?
Will do, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. That moves us to 120-2. Would you read that, please, ma'am?
Resolution 120-2, a resolution to approve and accept applications for notary public positions, the bonds and oaths of notaries previously elected, the oaths of deputy sheriffs, and to file the bond of Hamilton County 911 Emergency Communications District.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Jeter, a second by Commissioner Smedley. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. Bankston?
Yes.
Mr. Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. 120, would you read that, please, ma'am?
Resolution 120-3, a resolution to appoint one member to the Hamilton County Health and Safety Hearing Board beginning January 15th, 2020, and ending January 15th, 2024. This resolution appoints Emily Goldberg.
Second.
Okay, I've got a motion by, who did that motion? Commissioner Martin, and a second by Commissioner Smedley. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd? Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. 120-4, would you read that, please, ma'am?
Resolution 120-4, a resolution to reappoint one member to the Hamilton County Health and Safety Hearing Board beginning January 15th, 2020, and ending January 15th, 2024. This resolution reappoints Andrew C. Mullins.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Martin. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Mr. Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes. 120-5, read that, please, ma'am.
Resolution 120-5, a resolution confirming the reappointment of Randy Metcalf and Ernest C. Knoll Jr., and the appointment of Chris Adams by the county mayor to the Hamilton County Contractors Board of Appeals and Adjustments for terms ending January 15th, 2024.
Move to approve.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Martin, a second by Commissioner Smedley. And Dr. Mackey, is yours on this?
It is. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'm just wondering out loud. We reappoint a lot of people to these boards. Is that the best thing to do? Should we not look for new blood and involve more Hamilton County citizens in running government?
Maybe it should. I don't want to. The mayor's not here this morning. He's, by the way, I didn't make the announcement. He had a engagement this morning that he's going to try to make it here in a little bit. One thing I and maybe if he comes, he can expound on this. One thing I've heard him mention before is there's not a lot of people out there standing in line saying, will you appoint me for a board? Of course, we know on some of these boards, it's time consuming. It takes quite a bit of time out of people's out of their day, off their job and stuff. And I feel like sometimes it's just my feeling, what the reappointments come from sometimes is these are people that are willing to serve and said, yes, I will serve again. Now that's my point. Maybe you can, because a lot of these appointments are, I think this might be one of them, are recommended by the mayor, and then we approve. So I've heard him say that in the past, but that might be a good question for him.
You know, as you say that, Mr. Chairman, the nine of us sitting here, I'm sure we can go out, canvass our district, and find new people to bring into these positions. And all you and I have heard many, many times this term of term limits. We get term limits because we have to run and be re-endorsed to sit in these chairs. I'm just wondering out loud, do we need to bring more people into governing this county? Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And you made a good point there. So it seems like it would behoove us to submit some names sometimes to the mayor and say, Mr. Mayor, here's some people I've talked with that's willing to serve. If you have an opening and they fit this criteria, this would be some good.
If he put it before us, I'm sure somebody up here can find someone to take on these appointments.
Right. I've got a few more. Thank you, Dr. Mackey. I've got a few more. Commissioner Smedley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just in response to Commissioner Mackey, I agree with you, Commissioner Mackey, in Resolution 123. Emily Goldberg is replacing someone that's been on that board for 12 years, just for the reasons you're stating. I would encourage you all, if you're out looking for new people to fill these positions, to also try to get more women involved. Thank you.
Amen.
Commissioner Baker.
So, Commissioner Mackey, you make a really good point. And as it relates to like our appointments at Erlanger, I had both a very esteemed doctor ask
and a retired college professor asked me about they wanted to serve on that, and because they asked, they weren't allowed to serve, which I thought was interesting.
Wow.
So I think you make a great point. You know, both of these individuals would have been excellent. Not that the other ones aren't excellent, but I think that's a very good point. I was excited that they asked me about those positions, but I was a little disturbed that because they asked. Thank you.
Okay. No more lights. We've got a motion and a second for 120-5. Roll call, please.
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smidley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbank?
Yes. 120-6. Read that, please, ma'am.
Resolution 120-6, a resolution to authorize the county mayor to enter into a contract between the state of Tennessee, Department of Military, Tennessee Emergency Management Agency, and Hamilton County in the amount of $150,500.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Jeter, a second by Commissioner Smedley. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. 120-7, read that, please, ma'am.
Resolution 120-7, a resolution approving an interlocal agreement between Hamilton County and the Hamilton County Department of Education relative to the bulk fuel and retail fuel card programs, and authorizing the county mayor to sign any documents necessary to implement this resolution.
Move to approve.
Second.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Martin, a second by Dr. Mackey. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smidley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbank?
Yes. 120-8, read that, please, ma'am.
Resolution 120-8, a resolution establishing the minimum bid amount for certain parcels of property acquired by Hamilton County through previous delinquent tax sales, authorizing the offer of said parcels for sale at that minimum bid amount, and authorizing certain said parcels to be offered for sale for an amount less than the total amount of taxes, penalty, cost, and interest accumulated against the property.
Got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Jeter. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes. 120-9, read that, please, ma'am.
Resolution 120-9, a resolution to declare certain county-owned real property surplus and to authorize that such property to be offered for sale according to the sale procedures of Hamilton County's 2020 property sale.
Second.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Sharp. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbank?
Yes. I've got a lot on Dr. Mackey.
Hey, Mr. Chairman, can we be supplied with a list of these surplus properties?
Todd, we can. Or who would do that, Todd or?
Well, I'll bring Paul up, but I may be. If you're just talking about the only ones that y'all are surplusing are the Newell Tower and the IT building, which is on East 7th Street, and the minimum bid's $1.5 million for that property that's being surplused.
Those two. At $1.5 for both those?
Correct.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Did we vote on that? Okay. Okay. We've got 120-10. 120-11, 120-12, 120-13, 120-14, 120-15, 120-16, 120-17, and 120-18. Those went to finance. Will you read those, please, ma'am?
Resolution 120-10, a resolution approving the purchase of Dell desktop computers amounting to $31,052.64 from Insight Public Sector from the state contract SWC 49580 for the Hamilton County Sheriff's Office and authorizing the county mayor to sign any contracts necessary to implement this resolution. Resolution 12011, a resolution approving the purchase of an annual maintenance contract for Inform RMS software amounting to $49,609.60 from Central Square Technologies DBA Tri-Tech Software Systems for 1 year beginning August 7th, 2019 through August 6th, 2020 for the Sheriff's Office and authorizing the county mayor to sign any contracts necessary to implement this resolution. Resolution 12012, a resolution accepting the donation of 800 feet of containment boom and trailer valued at $25,000 from Inglewood Enterprises LLC and authorizing the county mayor to sign any documents necessary to implement this resolution. Resolution 12013, a resolution to relinquish Hamilton County's interest in a 1994 Ford Super Duty pickup truck co-titled with Dallas Bay Volunteer Fire Department. Resolution 12014, a resolution to authorize the county mayor to enter into a contract with Woolpert, Inc. to provide Hamilton County with geographic information system color and color infrared digital orthophotography at a cost of $184,500 and to amend the Hamilton County GIS partnership budget by adding $120,000 to revenue and $184,500 to expenditures. Resolution 12015, a resolution authorizing the county mayor on behalf of Hamilton County, Tennessee, the Health Services Division, operating as the Chattanooga Hamilton County Health Department, to sign a continuation contract with the Tennessee Department of Health for the time period July 1st, 2020 through June 30th, 2021, in an amount of $230,000 to provide for the period July 1st, 2020 for the coordination of fetal infant mortality review and community infant mortality reduction services in accordance with the Tennessee Department of Health's guidelines. Resolution 12016, a resolution authorizing the county mayor on behalf of Hamilton County, Tennessee, the Health Services Division operating as the Chattanooga Hamilton County Health Department, to sign a continuation contract with the Tennessee Department of Health in the amount of $283,300, $94,400 for the first 2 years, and $94,500 for the third year to provide services of the Tennessee Breast and Cervical Cancer Early Detection Program to eligible women in Hamilton County for a time period of July 1st, 2020 through June 30th, 2023. Resolution 12017, a resolution authorizing the county mayor to sign a lease agreement in the amount of $9,445 annually with Chattanooga Church Ministries, Inc., DBA Chattanooga Community Kitchen for space for use by Hamilton County, Tennessee, the Health Services Division operating as the Chattanooga Hamilton County Health Department's Homeless Health Care Center for the period of January 1st, 2020 through December 31st, 2020. Resolution 12018, a resolution accepting the bid of NABCO Electric Company, Inc. for the installation of a new traffic signal at East Brainerd Road and Bentwood Cove Drive amounting to $297,563 for the Hamilton County Engineering Department, and authorizing the county mayor to sign any contracts necessary to implement this resolution.
These went to finance, Commissioner Smedley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Resolution 12010, this is a resolution for the purchase of a Dell desktop computers. This is coming out of the general capital outlay. It's replacing 48 of 250 laptops. All these are 6 years old. I move to approve.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Baker. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Mr. Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes.
Resolution 12011, this is an annual maintenance contract for Inform RMS software. It's used throughout the agency for records management. It's used to track cases, property evidence, and used for state reporting. And Mr. Bernard was here last week and very eloquently explained everything. So I move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Baker. Roll call, please.
Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd? Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes.
Resolution 12012. This resolution is accepting the donation of 800 feet of containment boom. It's valued at $25,000, and this will help us deal with hazardous spills. We deal with, it was discussed last week, approximately 17 to 18 spills annually. And just to remind you all, this does cover 10 counties, the Homeland Security District. I move to approve.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Jeter. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Resolution 12013. This resolution is surplusing a 1994 Ford Super Duty vehicle. It was discussed last week that no fire departments wanted it because it's cost prohibitive to keep, and this will allow us to sell it to a farmer. I move to approve.
Second.
Got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Sharp. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Resolution 12014, this is a resolution to enter into a contract with Wolpert, Inc. to provide Hamilton County with geographic information system. They will fly over this winter. This is something they do every 2 years. This is not budgeted, so I'm going to call on Mr. Kaiser, if you don't mind explaining to the commission how these funds are being dealt with.
Yes. Thank you, Commissioner. This flyover was not budgeted, so therefore we have got it. We're setting up this budget over in the partnership area of our budget, and this is approving $184,000, $60,000. It gets confusing because we're moving money around from the GIS budget. Does have the $60,000 budgeted, but we are moving that $60,000, and the city of Chattanooga is paying $60,000. Into this fund, and then the partnership budget has $64,000 in its retained earnings, or its fund balance, that makes up the whole $184,000. So there's $60,000 from us, $60,000 from the city of Chattanooga, and $64,000 out of fund balance.
I move to approve.
I got a question.
Okay.
Move to approve.
Second.
I've got a motion by Commissioner Smedley and a second by Dr. Mackey. I have a question there, Al. First of all, you said it wasn't budgeted, but in through there somewhere, there was some budgeted money somewhere for that. But so my question was, before we got to that point, when we said unbudgeted, was this something we didn't know we were going to do?
I don't know why it wasn't put in the budget. It probably wasn't planned. We weren't sure we were going to do it at the time.
But some money got in one budget there.
There is. We planned in the GIS department, there's $60,000 that we can spend on this.
Okay.
This flyover, and I think they budget for that. And or I know they do. And in the partnership part of the budget, of our general fund budget, this was not, none of this was budgeted. So
okay.
I don't know whether it was oversight or what, but we.
Okay. Any other questions?
I'll just say this, since they do this every 2 years, maybe tell them to budget it next time.
I think I kind of picked up on that.
I did too.
Okay, roll call, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Resolution 12015, this resolution is a continuation contract. This is for funds that's used for fetal infant mortality review. And just for your knowledge, the rate has gone down. It did go down in 2018 below the state average. I move to approve.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Jeter. Commissioner Smedley, let me ask, like usually in Ms. Barnes' budget, this is a pass-through from
yes,
the state?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, thank you. Roll call, please.
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes.
Resolution 120-16, this is also a continuation contract. This is for women. For the funds are used for breast and cervical cancer program. Helps women without coverage. I move to approve.
Got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Dr. Mackey. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman Fairbanks?
Yes.
Resolution 120-17, this is a lease agreement with the community kitchen. It's the same amount as it always is. I move to approve.
Motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Jeter. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Resolution 120-18, this is for the installation of a traffic signal where the new middle school will be constructed there at East Brainerd and Bentwood Cove Drive. The time frame on this is about 6 months. We really need to approve this today to get the process going, since that school is slated to open August 2020. I will just say for the record that there was a traffic study done, and from that, it was determined that this traffic signal is needed. Move to approve.
Second.
We've got a motion by Commissioner Smedley, a second by Commissioner Baker. Roll call, please.
Mr. Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes. Thank you, Commissioner. We'll move to resolutions 120-19, 120-20, 120-21, 120-22, 120-23, 120-24A, 120-24B, and 120-25. These went to zoning. Would you read those, please, ma'am?
Resolution 120-19, a resolution to amend the master list of roads and speed limits so as to accept the following district road and to establish a speed limit therefore, Baldwin Field Circle. Resolution 120-20, a resolution to amend the master list of roads and speed limits so as to accept the following district road and to establish a speed limit therefore, Highborn Lane. Resolution 120-21, a resolution to amend the master list of roads and speed limits so as to accept the following district roads and to establish speed limits therefore, Bull Run, Longhorn Street, and Shorthorn Court. Resolution 120-22, a resolution to amend the master list of roads and speed limits so as to accept the following district roads and to establish speed limits therefore, Silk Road and Cashmere Lane. Resolution 120-23, a resolution to amend the master list of roads and speed limits so as to accept the following district road and to establish a speed limit therefore, River Breeze Drive. Resolution 120-24A, a resolution to rezone from A1 Agricultural District, R2A Rural Residential District, and R5 Single-Wide Manufactured Home District to C3 General Business Commercial District, and R1 Single-Family Residential District for properties located in the 9300 block of East Brainerd Road and 8942 Bel Air Road. Resolution 120-24B, a resolution to rezone from A1 Agricultural District, R2A Rural Residential District, and R5 Single-Wide Manufactured Home District to C3 General Business Commercial District, and R1 Single-Family Residential District for properties located in the 9300 block of East Brainerd Road and 8942 Bel Air Road. Resolution 120-25, a resolution to rezone from A1 Agricultural District and R2A Rural Residential District to R1 Single-Family Residential District for property located at 8875 Hickson Pike.
These went to zoning. Commissioner Bankston.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Resolution 120-19, 120-20, 21, 22, 23, those are all roads, and they have been inspected and meet all county standards from our engineering department. So I'll make a motion that we approve.
Okay, I've got a motion by Commissioner Bankston and a second by Dr. Mackey, and I've got a lot on Commissioner Sharp.
Thank you, Chairman. We had some good conversation about these particular, well, maybe not these particular roads, but roads in general as we continue to grow as a county. In our meeting last week, And I just wanted to make note that our RPA and Todd Liebman and his crew, they are taking some steps, I think, that are very productive as we grow and our infrastructure expands, that the expenses and maintenance that accompanies that growth would be, you know, not net negative, which I think is great for the taxpayers of Hamilton County, and I look forward to seeing how we progress with that. Thank you very much.
Okay, Mr. Clerk, we've got a motion and a second to approve 120-19, 120-20, 120-21, 120-22, and 120-23. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Yes.
Commissioner Sharp?
Yes.
Mr. Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, Chair Bank?
Yes.
120-24A and 120-24B have been pulled by the request of the applicant. 120-25 came out of committee with a recommendation to approve. Make a motion to approve.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Bankston, a second by Commissioner Sharp. And Commissioner Bankston, do we, is there anyone here today in
For 120-25,
yes.
They are present, yes.
The applicant?
The applicant.
Okay, so no.
They were no
opposition. Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Chairman, I have my light on.
Oh, hang on just 1 second, a light. Commissioner Martin.
Mr. Attorney, I'm not exactly sure how to do this. I need to recuse myself on this. I've got property listed adjoining to it. Do I vote? Just don't vote?
Yes.
Commissioner, based on the statement that you gave, you just announced that you would not be voting, and you've given the reason already.
Thank you. I'm not voting.
So you do that at the roll call, or is that sufficient?
Was it just one particular resolution?
That just this one piece of property here, I have adjoining property that I have listed with my business, and I think it would be inappropriate for me to vote on a rezoning matter that potentially could impact me in a positive way. I think that'd be unfair.
Okay, well, Mr. Clerk, I think that announcement would be sufficient now, for even though the vote hadn't come up yet.
Call his name.
Just call his name and then just announce abstaining.
Okay.
Commissioner Baker?
Yes.
Commissioner Bankston?
Yes.
Commissioner Boyd?
Yes.
Commissioner Jeter?
Yes.
Dr. Mackey?
Yes.
Commissioner Martin?
Abstain.
Mr. Sharp?
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Okay, that's all from the zoning. And that's all our resolutions we have on our agenda today. We'll go to announcements. Commissioner Bankston.
No announcement.
Dr. Mackey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, two things this morning, one of which, it used to be that people questioned Hamilton County government in two ways. One, it had to do with open government and violating the Sunshine Rule, and of late, and you notice, that doesn't come up anymore. The other thing, and it's even more important to me, is that people wanted to make sure the money was being spent correctly. And I want to commend Commissioner Smedley in running the Finance Committee. You may have noticed that she went a step beyond this morning. It was some monies that we were going to spend that was unbudgeted, and she took time to make sure that we were doing the right thing. So, again, Commissioner Smedley, I want to thank you for your leadership there. The other thing, Mr. Chairman, has to do with it's a governmental item. I got a telephone call from a friend yesterday, and it had to do with and I want to call it the refugee program. I don't have my notes, but there is a program that the director of that program can't complete their budget without, and they got to do it by the 21st of this month, but they can't do it unless the head of county government sign off. And I don't know if anybody is from the refuge. There he is. Okay.
And the board chair, Lester, both be here. You had said it might be 10:30
right
before the public period came up, so they probably, I know they're on the way in.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Can Jim Frierson help me lay out what need to be done or what is being spoken about?
Yes. Yes, he can.
Would you come forward?
He can.
I'm more than willing to do that. I just want to say I'm a friend of the organization since the late 90s. I'm not on the board.
Let's get on the record. Give me your name and address.
Happy to do it, Mr. Chairman. I'm Jim Frierson, F-R-I-E-R-S-O-N, native son, and most recently, Mayor Coppinger had asked me to be one of the co-chairs of the Hamilton County Bicentennial Planning Committee. So with your historian, Linda Moss Mines, I was just here last spring to lay out what was going to happen through that whole wonderful, glorious celebration. Greg Martin has also been vital to that. So I've got a historical perspective. I'm a native son, but I've also worked in international trade negotiations during the Reagan years. So I've had a chance to see the global economy, the impact that it has all this has happened in our lifetimes here in Hamilton County. This is a very transformed community. Bridge Refugee Services, as some of you know, has been since 1996 the officially designated resettlement agency in Hamilton County, serving Metropolitan Chattanooga as the receiving entity for those who our State Department has vetted over several years who are fleeing persecution, either political or religious or cultural or ethnic of some kind. And that program, I realize, has been going on in Hamilton County since 1978 through faith-based organizations. Catholic Charities, I think, was really the forerunner. Today, the Episcopal Migration Ministries, a national entity of the Episcopal Church, of which I'm a parishioner, now is the agency that receives funding in order to properly receive and settle and provide support to those refugees from those torn countries. It has operated both Chattanooga and Knoxville offices in the other two major cities, Nashville and Memphis. It's a combination of, I believe, Episcopal and Catholic entities. But the point is, this is really a faith-based program. This is not primarily an extension of federal, state, or county government. The role of the federal government, and now Governor Lee as the chief executive of Tennessee, and of the county mayors in those four major metropolitan areas of Tennessee, is to sign on to a new, a revamped program, which is actually smaller, way smaller in numbers than any of them can answer any questions that you, Mayor Coppinger, might have. And second, and this is what the governor did, clarify that this is not about our immigration policy. This is not about, Lord knows, it's not about undocumented immigrants, but it's not about immigration of legal immigration. This is about people who jumped through many more hoops for many years to be certified as true refugees seeking persecution. And our embassies play that frontline role, and ultimately the State Department, United Nations, and faith-based organizations are the partners. That is the program, and I am happy for Marina now to be here and to answer any questions, but I think it's so true to our history, so true to our purpose as a country. I can't imagine why we would not want to be on the right side of this issue. Marina.
Thank you. If you want to say something, will you give us your name and address, please, ma'am?
Marina Pastoriano, 1906 Skyline Drive, Chattanooga, Tennessee, 37421.
Okay. Let me just say, before you got here, I mean, he reluctantly said he was stepping in, but I think Mr. Frierson done an excellent job, as far as I'm concerned, on telling us exactly, you know, what the program was and what the process was. If you want to add something to that, you may.
Right. I'm very good with numbers.
I appreciate that.
I'm an associate director of Bridge for 20 years. I worked as a teacher at the Hamilton County Schools before. I'm an immigrant myself, and I want to believe that I'm one of many who brought value and positive impact to our community. But it's, of course, for you to decide. During the years with Bridge, I learned a lot about people who don't have a voice through no fault of their own. In 1951 convention in Geneva, after World War II, millions of displaced people, many countries signed in that convention, deciding that we will never let this happen again. The definition of refugees that was developed during the convention was people who fled their country and have well-based fear for their life based on the persecution because of their race, religion, or political affiliation. We are used to our freedom. It's the most valuable thing that we have. Believe me, I'm coming from former Soviet Union. I know the value of being able to speak to you today openly that I didn't have for the first half of my life. It's very important that we understand that these are the most vulnerable people. They were forced to leave and they don't have a place to go. United States always was and will be a beacon of hope and beacon of light for people who need a chance to rebuild their lives. And refugees are those people. And Hamilton County proudly resettled refugees for four decades, maybe quietly, but still they're here, they're your neighbors, they are teachers in your schools. I know professors in UTC who are refugees, they don't necessarily talk about that. They are business owners of some of the big privately owned companies, trucking companies and construction companies. They're business owners that are present here who start their business with refugees in mind to help them integrate. They work in food processing, and we have a letter signed by the Pilgrim's Pride how they value the input of refugees. They bring social and economic value. There is no question about that. The rate of employment for people who came through our agency is between 93% and 97%. They become self-sufficient in first 4 to 5 months. The federal funding that we receive is enough for us to help them start their life. After that, they pay taxes and they contribute it in every other way, like we do. There are people with different stories, and Jim Frierson talked about Sergio. By the way, he has 3 Emmy Awards for documentaries. Here today, you only is present Wahab Alabid. He is the representative of the Iraqis who made a choice to help American military, risking their own lives and risking lives of their loved ones. It took years for him to come to the United States. The average vetting process takes 24 months for people to go through all the clearances that are needed and be able to come to U.S. He is a member of our board. He is a homeowner. He is an active participant in an Adventist group that helps refugees in our community. He is a father, he is a grandfather, and he is the stand-up citizen. And he is here if you have any questions.
I think, Mr. Frierson, will you come back up here a second? I believe I have a question. Let me understand, through y'all's presentation, let me understand that these are federal dollars that come into our county, strictly federal dollars?
11 programs that we have, all of them are employment and integration programs, are only federal funding. We do not receive.
Okay. So the way I understand it, the dollars is all federal money, but the way, Mr. Frierson, you told us, the chief executive of the state and of the county that the money comes to just has to agree, I guess, to accept the money.
I think.
Do I understand that correctly?
You understand correctly. I think President Trump makes every year, the President of the United States makes every year determination of how many people will come and where they will come from.
Okay.
And then this year, this is the first year where he also had an executive order to seek consent of the localities where they're resettled to enhance this us working together,
mm-hmm.
you know, to make sure that the communities support what the federal government does. To, as I said about numbers, we have active 120 to 150 volunteers every given year. The last count of volunteer hours is 1,600 hours.
Chattanooga, that
were donated just in 6 months. We provide internship and volunteer opportunities for SWANI, UTC, Southern Adventist University. It's a private-public partnership. It's very important to understand that community stands behind us all the way.
Ms. Passerini. Ms. Chairman, I appreciate your indulgence to hear this presentation. I think they've said what they needed to say. I don't want to prolong this opportunity, but again, I want to thank you and this commission for allowing us to speak. I don't know if they need to say anything more, but I think the message has been sent.
Commissioner Mackey, I would add only, and I just learned this in the last 24 hours, the governor, so I'm wondering who the governor's staff person was on this, lawyer that I am. Yeah. I'm thinking it's some council policy person. Well, it turns out that native Chattanoogan, Dave Warland, very involved in foundation work, faith-based work here in Chattanooga, was appointed in Governor Lee's middle of his first year in office to head a new office of faith-based initiatives. Any question about this program as it works across these four cities in the state of Tennessee is handled on the Governor Lee's behalf by Dave Warland, who I remember meeting, but the fact that any of us can pick up the phone and say, Dave, help us understand why this issue is even hanging open anywhere when you consider what it's got going for it. But I felt very comforted to know, A, that the grounding of this is ultimately a faith-based program. The federal dollars make it happen and authorize it, but without all of the involvement of the churches and congregations, it really, and the internships, the volunteers, it wouldn't happen. Second, the reason this administration, I say, revamped the program, there were some feelings in states and localities where the program was more informally run than it is in Tennessee. Having four offices, it makes us really unusual. There's some states that have no program like this. Georgia doesn't have as many operations as Tennessee does. I think this administration wanted to formalize this process of consultation with both the governor and the locality. And locality is defined in the executive order as the chief executive.
I'm going to cut you off.
That's it.
Thank you. But the point being, by the 21st, we need to take some kind of action.
Yes. And
a positive.
The last thing I want to tell you, it's a life-saving humanitarian program. We have a choice to make, and it has to be the right choice that we will,
Thank you for your time. Ms. Chairman, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. We will be available for any questions in the future, please.
I do have a lot on. She wants to make a comment. Commissioner Jeter.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really, real quickly, just
sure.
Clarification, because I've been following this a little closely, but isn't it correct that the executive order limited, and it's a clarification and I guess a question, limited the number of refugees into the United States, and I guess that's nationally, to 18,000. Mm-hmm. Is that correct? So,
residential determination is made every year on October 1st, and this year it's 18,000.
So when I heard that, I don't know, in previous years, like the numbers, but that seems very devastating.
Small number.
Very small numbers. So, I mean, this is a very important matter, and I'm so thankful that the both of you are here to bring this to our attention. And I also will say that your organization, you mentioned, Mr. President, you know, since 1996, like, you guys have been a part of Hamilton County. And besides the everything that you guys spoke of, the one thing that I heard was you guys are part of Hamilton County. The refugees, everything that you guys do, this is family. This is part of Hamilton County, and that's why this matters. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the commission. If y'all would stay at the podium.
All right, we're in.
Thank you. I knew there was a reason I was at another appointment this morning. I knew there was a reason I needed to be here. Just didn't know what it was. Sometimes, you know, God works in mysterious ways, right? But thank you for being here, and I'm going to tell you why. There is a lot of misinformation, and this issue is being misrepresented in our community in a really bad way. First of all, you know, this started back, if you go back to the Vietnam War. A lot of the refugees that came here from Vietnam were working for our government, much like what you said about the gentleman from Iran, were given information and risk in their lives, and they're not illegal immigrants. And I want to make sure that, you know, because I've spent a lot of time in the last couple of weeks and gotten a lot of assistance from legal people and other people to make sure I understood the issue. It wasn't about whether or not I've made up my mind about signing it or not. It's about, you know, the fact that it is so hard. You cannot overcome social media. I'm just telling you. And some of the things that's been said is just so far-fetched. But I want to make sure, from point of clarification, that everybody should understand a couple of things. And I want to get back to the city of Chattanooga. I know that Mayor Burke signed that. Does that not mean they could still come to Chattanooga? Or does the county have to sign to allow them to come to Chattanooga? I don't know.
Okay. As you know, as we mentioned, this is a new thing. This is a completely new executive order, a new request from the President Trump. At the beginning, and I think still there is some questioning about jurisdictions and who has to sign. As time goes by and I look at the list on the State Department website who signed, you will see that some jurisdictions are city, and some jurisdictions are municipalities, and some are townships. It's very intensive legally for the social worker like me. For your, the answer to your question, it's very clearly says, state in the paragraph 2, subparagraph B, it says, and it's executive order 13888, that the governor of the state and the executive of the locality, brackets, county or county.
Other states have other types of territories.
It has this word, if you, we absolutely have to have Mayor Coppinger, your consent.
And Mayor Coppinger.
In order for them to come to Chattanooga, although the city of Chattanooga has already signed, okay, so how would that impact the other smaller municipalities? Is the signature of the county mayor authorize refugees to go into the other nine municipalities, or?
We're talking about initial resettlement. I think Governor Lee gave a very good explanation about why he signed it, and one of the points he made, he said, we want to know who comes to our state. We want to have a control. And his example was, you have to understand, somebody who is a refugee in North Carolina can just take a car and drive to Tennessee. So what he talked about is initial resettlement. These people who will fly directly to Chattanooga, these people that we will have their bio and all the information ahead of time, these people who will be resettled, will be resettled in Chattanooga, Hamilton County. because we have certain requirements, and it is infrastructure, and it is affordable housing, and it is jobs that are available, we will always stay within the parameters where this is easily accessible. So I don't see us, and we never had in the past, resettled people in other counties. I mean, in other municipalities. What is the name?
There's several of them.
Right. Farther than the city limits.
The President Trump's order obviously couldn't describe to 50 states
how
they are organized. So, yes, Louisiana has parishes, and some New England places have townships that are not part of counties. So he couldn't say counties. They said locality. But they issued a clarification, because many people asked the same question you did, and they said this means the chief executive of the appropriate subsidiary branch of state government, which is the county. Second, Governor Lee, in December, after he sent the letter to Secretary Pompeo saying we're on board, and for all the right reasons, impassioned personal thing, he then sent a similar letter to the Speaker of the House and the Lieutenant Governor, as the constitutional officers of those two bodies, informing them, because they don't, as the legislative body, they don't play a role in making the decision, but he informed them, and he made it abundantly clear that in the state of Tennessee, locality means county. And he even said, if, despite my approval, a given county that has been part of this program declines to issue that letter, then the federal government, State Department, would not have the authority to settle a family there, barring an extraordinary finding by the Secretary of State that for some humanitarian reason, a family or intensive medical care, it would be a very rare situation. And this administration, I think, it would go out of its way to avoid anything that looked like a placement of a family under the protest of the governing local authority. So, sir, this issue is in front of you and you alone.
Well, thank you very much. I've followed what Governor Lee's done, what he said, and well aware of the meeting you were talking about. The other issue I was going to ask you about, I mean, I think this is really important on a local issue. If the letter wasn't signed by the 21st, it doesn't mean that refugees can't and won't come here. What it means is there won't be any federal money that comes with the refugees, right?
Or information about them.
Yes. They will not be initially resettled here, but we have freedom of movement. Chattanooga is a very attractive city.
Right.
And I think there will still be people whose friends or relatives will vouch, you know, with right. our low unemployment rate, with our still a little bit affordable housing that we have. I think turning back on the federal funding, but most importantly, on all this preliminary information that the agency will receive, and the agency attached and committed to every refugee to succeed, will be not the right decision.
Lose the benefit of that partnership. You'd sort of be back to the good old days in a bad new world, you know, of actors that we're all conscious of. Finally, I go back to Dave Warland. At the governor's side is a native Chattanoogan running this Office of Faith-Based Initiatives. Anything that we haven't answered satisfactorily, I guarantee you Dave Warland can. I've reached out to him to let him know that this issue is absolutely in front.
Let me just wrap this up this way. I mean, because again, I've gotten, as you can imagine, several phone calls and people, there is a misunderstanding. I mean, first of all, when I explain to people, these are not illegal immigrants. These are people that have been, most importantly, they've been vetted thoroughly by, you know, the Trump administration through the State Department. They're not coming here without a lot of background information on them. It's not like, you know, some people try to equate this to people crossing the border in Mexico, and that is not what's going on here. It's just that, you know, for the first time that I'm aware of ever, The President of the United States decided to sign an executive order that stated, such as what you're saying, the governor has to accept it in a local locale. It's not like refugees, they've been coming in this county for as long as I've probably been alive, but for as long as I know. And you know, the, what's making this, you know, kind of a hot topic, if you will, is a lot of the misrepresentation of what these people represent. I mean, I think if you went out there and you talked I will say I've gotten a lot of calls in favor of it, too, and a lot of it comes from what you're talking about, churches and people that represent faith-based, because, I mean, these are people who generally deal a lot with refugees sometimes when they come here. And I'm glad that you came here to be able to have this conversation publicly. I think there needs to be a whole lot more said about. I don't think there's been enough good information given to the public to understand. I mean, it's really key to understand how thoroughly these people, these 18,000 people that were vetted, and I think we had 80 that came into Hamilton County last year. They were vetted and they weren't illegal and they were productive in our community. And, you know, that was when they were allowing 30-some-odd to come in nationwide. So now that they've reduced the number to 18, you know, the likelihood of it exceeding that amount of people is not great. It's hard to be. I always say the thing about local government and the thing about being governor too, I'm sure, is sometimes, I mean, you know, you got to make those hard choices that are misrepresented that always don't come across as being real popular. But I have a lot of respect for you've been in my office. We've had this discussion of what your organization does and has been doing for a long time. I mean, people think this is brand new. The only thing that's new is the executive order. And I thank you for your time.
St. Mark's Methodist Church resettled Bosnian family in 2000. Their last name was Liško. I looked up. I'm very proud to tell you that probably each of your churches participated and supported us over the year. We just never were asked to bring it to this level of discussion. And I would like in the future to give you more information and to get more involved with Hamilton County government.
Okay, let me say, I've got one other line on, I'm going to recognize it, and then I'll ask if we go ahead. The point was made in the beginning, and the mayor says he's glad the public was able to hear it through this, but I'm going to recognize this one last commissioner, and then I would ask that we cut the discussion off, because it sounds like this is not an issue that the commission will vote on. So it's either a signature or no signature, and it sounds like y'all have met and there's things that you want
to. Your understanding and support is wonderful to have in community terms, but
yes.
The actor is the county manager.
Yes. So let me, Commissioner Martin's got his light on.
I just have one question, but Mayor, I want to thank you for being deliberative and thoughtful and thinking through this process and doing due diligence on that as you do on so many subjects as you have on this, and I appreciate the citizens of Hamilton County appreciate you being thoughtful and deliberate when you make your decision. It is years and years alone. It has nothing to do as far as the county legislative body making a decision. So I'm not real sure why we've talked about this, but I do have one question for clarification for the public. Mr. Frierson, I heard you kept saying the four counties, but does this not also apply to all 95 counties in the state of Tennessee? Is it only the four?
Unfortunately, no, because there are only four receiving agencies.
Resettlement.
That's all I need to know.
That operate in those.
That's all I wanted to know. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. Hang on. The mayor's got one more comment.
Yeah, just quickly, just so you'll know, and correct me if I'm wrong, because you're going to know, but I believe last year refugees actually came into eight counties in Tennessee. I mean, there may be only four placement centers, but I'm pretty sure I'm right about that. Was it eight counties or maybe more?
I don't have this information. My information, what I know through the state refugee coordinator office, okay, is that Shelby, Davidson, Knox, and Hamilton resettles initially. We might have refugees who come to live and
resettled.
Right, in other counties, but not the first 6 months or whatever you want to call it, the first initial period when they come through the agency. I also wanted to mention that our chair of the board, Martin Lester, the very famous immigration lawyer, is here. So if you have questions, we came prepared to answer everything that's on your mind. And thank you for giving it, Mayor Coppinger, so much thought. Unfortunately, everything has unfortunately a deadline. We've been talking about it, and you were very thoughtful and very supportive of us being able to present our issue. I hope that the decision will be to opt in. Thank you.
And I would just offer this commission an opportunity. If they want to weigh in by resolution, they can.
You know, Shelby County resettles only 40 people, and they had like the big presentation and resolution, and it was televised. I think we should be proud that we're given this opportunity and this honor to be part, small part, in the huge humanitarian mission.
Thank
combined.
You. Thank you, ma'am. And Jim, thank you. And your board chairman, thank you for being with us today. Let's move to Commissioner Martin for an announcement.
No announcements.
Oh, that was a good. Commissioner Jeter.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I do have a quick announcement. I want to publicly announce a new healthy living program that our Hamilton County Health Department is going to be putting on in District 5, specifically in zip code 37411. This is a pilot program that its goal is to reduce diabetes and high blood pressure amongst those residents in that specific zip code. And I just wanted to bring attention to this to the public as well as to the commission about how exciting that our health department, which Becky Barnes and her team does such an amazing job of finding initiatives like this that are very specific and targeted. And what is so unique about this, and I'm very honored to be a part of this work, is that it's basically community led and it's community driven. They are really being intentional about going into the community. And so I just wanted to again acknowledge Becky, Dr. Hendricks, Bill Armour, and many of the community partners. And it is also a lot of the faith-based entities are part of it. So again, Becky, thank you to you and your team. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, real quick. Oh, the kickoff is Saturday, January 25th at New Covenant. That was an important piece. So we're encouraging folks in the community to be supportive of this, and especially for the residents of District 5. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Smedley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to recognize Ron Tucker, fellow friend and realtor here from the Greater Chattanooga Association of Realtors. I have missed seeing you and Christy in our audience. So glad to see you back today.
Commissioner Baker.
Yes, thank you, Commissioner Jeter, for letting me know about that. I found out my son was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes the other day, so it's of great interest and concern. Speaking of which, I've invited you all. A couple months ago, I was speaking with Don Mueller, who's the CEO of Children's Hospital, and we started talking about the health of all our children in Hamilton County, and Becky, I know you. I'd love for you to attend this, but not just for the schools, you know, Hamilton County schools, but really, you know, all the children of Hamilton County, and all the things we've been hearing about. He's going to have some specialists that will be there to discuss the topics that are also national topics: mental health, vaping, and opioids, which are topics that we've all heard about. This is going to be an hour. Session, maybe an hour and a half if we ask questions. It's on the 27th at 6 p.m. at the new children's facility, so you get to see a beautiful children's facility. He tells me he's going to take care of us with great food, so that should be enough incentive right there. But, you know, it really is just, you know, it's an opportunity for us to since so much of our money goes into schools and so much of it goes into the healthcare of all our community, but children are certainly an extremely important part of what we do as parents, as leaders, as a community, as employees of the county. So I strongly urge, I know about six of y'all are coming, and I thank you for that, but I strongly urge you to get with Patricia, let her know that you can make it. It should be very, very informative, and, you know, if you haven't seen the new children's facility, it'll be a great place to hold the meeting. So I thank you for that, and I hope you all have a good day.
Mr. Clerk, before I move through the rest of the announcements, do you have your lights on? Do you have something for us?
She's going to mention the time of her meeting.
Okay.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Dawes, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. The kickoff for the healthy living is Saturday the 25th from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m., and again, that's going to be at New Covenant Baptist Church, and that is in District 5 off North Moore Road. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Sharp.
Thank you, Chairman. Just one question. I know that we've been talking about, or there's been some conversation around our speaker system in the back. I noticed today, like, I could barely hear anything. I got to get a cup of coffee and use the restroom, and I couldn't hear anything that was going on out here. So I was wondering if we're making any progress on that. Does anyone know? No? No, it's not. I'm curious. Sorry.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I was asking Bart, who does all of our stuff, or he's responsible for it, and have you received any complaint about it?
No. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, they all have volume switches on them. Probably the volume is turned down.
Well, I mean, I had on 10, so anyways. Anyway, that's another note. So for announcements, thank you. I'd like to commend our governor in his conviction and faith in supporting the refugee program, the federal refugee program. I hope that we can extend that same grace to those in need, that we can offer refuge to here with the help of the federal government. And I don't know if that's the type of support you're looking for from this body, Mr. Mayor, but I believe that our governor said it best, and I think that it was a very wise and careful decision. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyd.
Thank you, Chairman. Out of character for me to be so quiet this Wednesday morning.
I wouldn't push in my luck, Commissioner.
So I appreciate your recognizing me. In reference to the letter we got from Becky this morning about healthy living, living in a household with two PhDs that specialize in new drug discovery for healthcare, one's in endocrinology, one's in neurogenetics. I get a lot of conversations about childhood illness. Unbeknownst to many of this community, Chattanooga not only is the buckle of the Bible Belt, we are the buckle of the poor health in the U.S. Belt. And we have we're on the high scale of the norms for childhood diabetes, childhood obesity, fetal, infant, and early childhood mortality, childhood strokes. You don't think about children having strokes. Childhood cardiovascular issues, high blood pressure, hypertension. And not to mention, with all the work that Dr. Tom Devlin does and the Blaise Baxter does in stroke for adults, we're the buckle for childhood stroke. So it's extremely important that Becky has reached out to the Center for Disease and Prevention, CDC in Atlanta, to get this grant to move forward. Unfortunately, one of the reasons that Chattanooga receives the attention and the grants is because our sample pool is so large for these childhood diseases. So it's good, Becky, that we bring it to the attention of the community that we do have health issues with our children. Don Mueller and the work that's going on at Erlanger, we want to certainly support them in every way we can. I know the outreach by Children's Hospital to bring in more and more pediatric specialists is ongoing, and I certainly advocate and support that with all the staff, Don's staff over there. So just publicly, I'm really, really pleased that this Healthy Living Initiative has come to Chattanooga with the grant. And, you know, Becky, I wish all the best to the success of it. Thank you.
Okay, Dr. Mackey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, I know we've discussed the refugee topic quite a bit. I don't think any action was taken, and I have to apologize to the mayor for blindsiding him in a kind of a way, and in an effort to give him cover, I would love to, and if we can do it today, adopt a resolution where the commission endorse the refugee program as a way of giving the mayor cover, should he need it. And I know this has just been put on the table, but if it's possible, I'd like to make a propose a resolution that this body vote and thereby register its support of that refugee program.
And I'll take some opinions from other commissioners if they want. I know what we've heard about the program is what we've heard here today at the podium. It sounds like Mr. Mayor has had some meetings on it or something a little more than we've had today. But now, I mean, okay, I got another light on, Commissioner Smedley.
Mr. Chairman, just speaking for myself, I would need time to study this matter more. I thought the mayor brought up some good questions today, and I don't have a thorough understanding of it.
Okay. Well, let me get with after the meeting today. I don't think it's going to happen in today's meeting. Let me get with the Mr. Attorney and see if. And in the meantime, if we do that, then it's going to be on each commissioner to gather your information. If you need more information, I think the way that would be, it sounds like to me the way that would be, is if you wanted some meetings to set in with Mr. Frierson and the director there, the way the mayor has.
Mr. Chairman, it is so time sensitive. The 21st is Tuesday, and so it's and it came to me late. It came to me yesterday, the urgency of this, so for what it's worth.
Yep. Let me say, Commissioner Sharp.
Thank you, Chairman. I just wanted to ask if Commissioner Mackey's suggestion was in the form of a motion. I'll second that.
You know, Mr. Attorney, I'm looking for your guidance.
Mr. Chairman, you all are still in session. There's a motion been made and a second properly, and I had sought recognition because Commissioner Mackey just made a point that I think the deadline is the 21st. The next time you meet will be the 22nd. So, we can.
I don't think we'll meet till the, you know, we're skipping the 22nd.
Oh, you will.
I had that announcement.
Okay. So it will be after the fact. So if the commission wants to express its sentiment, I think that was what Commissioner Mackey's motion was. If the commission wants to express its sentiment to help the mayor, it would be in order.
So we're in order. So, Commissioner Mackey, then, if you're making a motion, would you state what your motion is for the clerk?
I will. Mr. Chairman, I make the motion that the Hamilton County Commission vote and register its support of the refugee program and support the mayor sending that letter, his letter in support.
Okay, that's our motion. Commissioner Sharp, is your second on that motion?
It is.
Okay. Commissioner Martin.
Yeah, I trust that this is a something that President Trump, and I was teasing Dr. Mackey about being on the Trump train, and
a wreck.
That this is a decision that's by the executive of the country, to the governor, to the county. I've had nothing in front of me, and I've even inquired about getting some information in front of me. I just don't think it would be I don't think I could cast a vote with not having all the information, that not having any information really other than just what we've heard. My heart is there. I mean, our country has welcomed people, but I to go on record, I just need to, it's really something the mayor makes a decision. If we voted to affirm him, he could do what he wanted to. He could do whatever he wants to. So it's his decision. It's not this commission's decision to make. And so I'm just going to have to abstain until I wish Dr. Mackey, you could have brought us some information a week ago.
I wish I had it a week ago.
I wish I had it this day. So, I mean, I get you wish you had it a week ago. I wish we had it today. And at the end of the day, it's the executive on the federal, state, and the local level's decision to make and not ours. And without having information, I don't like being put in this situation without the information.
Okay, I've got Commissioner Sharp's light on. Yeah.
Thank you, Chairman. And I appreciate these comments that are being made by my colleagues. And I understand the pressing timeline of this matter and how that puts people on the spot. No one likes being put on the spot, myself included. I would like to point out the fact that we have the experts in-house today. So if there are questions that are unanswered, then I would like to, obviously extend that opportunity to my colleagues to be able to ask those questions so we can find resolution and, essentially, do as in support of our mayor and show the
publicly show
the grace of Hamilton County and an extension of said grace to these potential well-vetted refugees. So I'm not sure what questions there may be, but Mr. Frierson or anyone else who is well-versed in this particular topic, if you'd like to take the podium to answer any questions that might help clarify and increase confidence for my colleagues, I hope that we would be able to do that today.
I've got a few more lights on. Commissioner Baker.
Yeah, Jim, if you don't mind. Podium, thank you. So how long has this been? When did the governor sign this?
Governor signed it on December 17th. Mr. Fryer, turn. Okay, we got your
mic. Governor Lee signed it. Is Marina still here? Yeah, Marina.
December 17th.
December 17th. And it was issued to the media as well as that letter, one letter to Secretary of State Pompeo. That's the official transmission of the governor's okay, the second letter to the House and Senate.
Yeah, so I mean, I would agree with what Commissioner Martin said that, it's gone from our president to, our governor, to here. I feel like, why are we just getting this if it's been a month old? If we're going to make a decision, Marina, feel free to come up. I do have some time so we can ask questions because that's the thing. I want to be fully informed as to what it means. My grandparents are immigrants, so a good friend of mine is a hotelier here, and he is all about immigration done the right way. And so, I just like to know more because it's just kind of silly that we're, being pressured into a quick decision without all the information.
That is a completely fair observation. And let me go personal for just a second. Again, I'm not a board member, hadn't really had a chance to even see Marina in recent months, but she saw me Thursday night at an event and said, I really need to talk to you. That was the arts bill thing. And she told me, I was very well aware, I read the papers, I'm a political animal, I knew what Governor Lee had done. And like many people, I thought that disposed of the issue.
But to show you how there's a difference between deliberate misinformation and just an information gap, let me also go personal with Clint Cooper on the editorial side of the Times Free Press, on the Free Press side. When I called Clint yesterday to commend him for an editorial he had Sunday, acknowledging the leadership of Governor Lee, in that editorial, there was no mention of the fact that, at least as to Hamilton County, which is the audience he's writing for, this issue is still open. And I thought maybe even Clint Cooper doesn't understand that, and in fact, he didn't. So if editors at the paper on the editorial page who are in the business of policy and thinking about issues are unaware, then this isn't just a deliberate effort to obscure the facts. So again, I learned of it Thursday night, and I said, I think there's some very important people you need to reach out to, you and your board, and Marty Lester is absolutely welcome to join in on this. Until this year, there hasn't been a process like this. I don't know that Marina's ever set foot in this very room. She had to ask me where the county commission was, to her credit. She, like me, did not for a second want our friend Mayor Coppinger to feel surprised, and when I reached Warren yesterday, who was the first county commissioner that she felt she had a personal working relationship with, I said to Warren, look, it's probably too late to even put it on the agenda. I'd love for it to be on the agenda so there's no surprise to Mayor Coppinger or legislative staff or county attorney or anyone. So it may not have been on the agenda, but second best was giving her and this organization their constitutional right to be heard on an issue that is timely. So again, Warren learned of it yesterday. I learned of it Thursday night. Clint Cooper learned of it yesterday. Having worked at the paper, I'm sure Clint will want to write another editorial before the 21st, depending upon the posture of this issue. If it looks like it is going affirmative and it's timely, then I think you would expect an equally positive editorial, similar to the one he wrote about Governor Lee on Sunday. If the issue is still hanging and open and he can weigh in, I think he wants to do that. He will take his cue from those of us that are on the front lines. But again, I only did it because Marina felt that I was sympathetic to this organization. And also, the faith basis of this program is what just impresses me the most. This is primarily not a governmental program. Government needs to authorize faith-based organizations and private entities in these communities to make it happen. I'm proud of Chattanooga's track record over 40 years informally and 20 plus years formally under this program. The numbers are down for some possibly good reasons, but that's only a 12-month decision. They'll be revised 12 months later. So the numbers part shouldn't be seized on too much because it could go back up, it could stay the same, it could go down next year. What's really important is this administration, for the first time, has given governors and locality executives the opportunity to say, we want to continue being part of this collaboration.
Let me make sure I understand this. They're coming. They're going to come anyway. And if we
but not necessarily to your locality.
Well, they are, is what I heard.
They're going to come to the United States, 18,000.
They're going to come to Hamilton County.
Not if the county mayor declines.
But they still could come, right?
To the United States.
And I don't mean they. I just mean the
vetted immigrants.
Okay, so if he signs this, then we get the information and we get the money from the government.
Correct.
But if we don't,
they'll go elsewhere.
They could still be here.
Later, they could resettle, as some people have done. This is a free country. But they don't come with the authority.
Okay, these are some of the questions. You're welcome to come up, Marty.
Yeah, Marty,
so. Also, I understand, what was it, 80
last year in Hamilton
here, and 40 in Shelby County? Is that right?
To speak briefly, Councilman Baker, to your first question, I think you're correct. My name is Martin Lester. I am the chairman of the board of Bridge Refugee Services, and I appreciate the opportunity to be in front of you today to address this very timely and very important issue. Councilman Baker, to answer your question, I think what you were getting at, if the locality does not agree to the resettlement of refugees, those refugees could resettle in another community and then come and move to Hamilton County. Absolutely. The difference would be, at that point, Hamilton County would not receive the information about the refugees, and it would not receive the federal funding. So were the mayor to decline to agree to allow refugees to be resettled in Hamilton County, those same individuals could be resettled in Knoxville and then 2 days later make the drive from Knoxville to Chattanooga, make Chattanooga their home, but the agencies here would not have the money or the funding. So perhaps
that information, yeah. And so is it true, though, that 40 last year in Shelby and 80 here? Is that correct number?
I can't tell you the precise numbers because I don't know them. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, it's my understanding, as Bridge Refugee Services is a local agency, we serve Chattanooga and Knoxville. The number of refugees who are resettled in those communities is actually decided partly at levels above us and partly based on the strength of our organization and, more importantly, its connection and its volunteer base in the local communities. So I think it's a positive testament to Hamilton County that in Hamilton County and in Knox County, there are hundreds of individuals, faith-based organizations, church teams who already right now are giving of their time and their treasure to support the refugee resettlement. And so I think that it's not just a question of the size of the community, it's a question of the size of the heart of the community.
Yeah. So if 40 were in Shelby, 80 were here, how many in Knox last year? Knox County, you would know that number?
Marina would know that exact
91
number.
91 in Knoxville, 86 in Chattanooga, 431 in state of Tennessee last year.
How many in Shelby?
I think 40, maybe 42.
Okay,
Nashville's probably the largest.
Okay.
Nashville, the largest.
So, you know, I'm getting back to my friend who's from India, and, you know, I don't have – I mean, we're a nation of immigrants. I mean,
sure,
like
course.
I said, my grandparents, both sides. But done right. And I think Jim made a great point when he said that they're vetted more than our kids, which – if you don't mind throwing my kids in that mix, that'd be good so I knew what they were doing. But, you know, so, I mean, they're going through the process right. And I think that one of the points that I've heard is we get the information, we get the money, we've got the support team set up. And I have the other three big counties signed off on it already?
Yes.
And so we're the only one that hasn't.
The soft deadline was 28th of December. It was extended to because by that time it was 3 months or 90 days that President Trump asked his executive order to be implemented by State Department. So we were in conversations with Mayor's office way before when the executive order was published, and we received guidance. Because it's something new, nobody actually knew how to understand. We're not politicians, we're not legal professionals, so it took a couple of weeks.
And this question of the locality did require clarification federally and in Tennessee.
We were on the conference call with the Bureau of Population, Refugee, and Migration and State Department.
Make sure you're speaking in the mic.
We were on a conference call with the director of the State Department Bureau Population, Refugees, and Migration, PRM, and she said, we're still trying to figure out the locality situation when it was first published. So it took a little bit of time to get all the guidance.
Over Christmas.
And then Christmas, and then, you know, time just...
Well,
I'm very sorry it came to your attention later, but... I also want you to know that several of the council members, commissioners, met with some constituents before today, and we were in conversations. All the information is public information. It's available. And as I stated, to Mayor Coppinger, it is in our prime interest to give you the best information available, because we are hoping for the long-term relationship. It is my understanding that we will be asked every year to secure the consent, and from now on, we would be very intentional in providing all the information to the county government. We hold quarterly consultations with the stakeholders and in Bridge. We just didn't have anybody from county government, and I think we should. But please don't doubt that it is integrity of our organization, integrity of our mission, and personal integrity that will prevent us from giving information that is questionable.
You know, it's interesting to know. I didn't know anything about this until actually when the Sheriff's Department, just rank and file, called me about it and was very much against it. Back to the optics, I think, Mayor. And I guess, you know, this is like anything. It's about education. I wish this wasn't kind of off the cuff today. I wish this should have been a topic that we put on the agenda, and I understand why. But this is a very important thing to our community, and it's important to educate our employees, our community. You know, it's unfortunate that you know it's kind of down to the wire, because like anything, I mean, I remember back when I ran a PGA Tour event, all these banks were sponsors, and they couldn't sponsor because it made it look bad, the optics. And the optics here is, I think we've done, you know, a poor job communicating and educating our community. Not you, just saying this topic. And, you know, that's you know, back to what the mayor was saying, is that there's a lot of misinformation out there. And again, we're a nation of immigrants. And this process, to me, appears to be done right. It's just, you know, like anything, it's how it's communicated to, you know, people. And so the fact that I got that call, I was like, huh, what? And then I, you know, heard more about it, but, you know, didn't have to do with us. So now it does. So, you know, I want to know more. I'm good.
Commissioner Boyd.
Thank you, Chairman. I'll be brief. I think Commissioner Baker hit the nail on the head when he says the optics look bad. I can't participate in a vote on any resolution concerning this because it's not fully vetted. We don't have anybody that's concerned with opposing this. I don't know why they would oppose it. But like Commissioner Martin said, our hearts are in the right place. We're trying to conduct good government here. Good government don't consist of hearing one side of the issue and not hearing the other side and then casting a vote. Sorry, it's time sensitive. That's not my fault. Don't have any control over that, but I can't participate in a vote on a resolution when I haven't been the issue hasn't been fully vetted. And everything you said here is positive. Well, I can just hear my phone ringing. Well, you never gave us a chance to talk. I don't even know why would they would argue it. It's not an issue to me. One question I do have. Have you ever resettled any refugees in East Ridge?
We have a community in East Ridge. It's a Bosnian community.
How many?
I don't know. This is something that we were talking about.
More than five.
More.
Less than 50.
More than 50.
More than 50. Okay. More than 50 of these people have settled in my district, in my hometown, which only consists of 20,000 people. And they're very, very nosy about political issues. Trust me. I have never, ever heard one of my constituents say a word about refugee settlement in East Ridge, knowing that we have a large refugee settlement in East Ridge. I knew the answer before I asked it. So as far as I'm concerned, no problem. The problem is good government, which we need to give the opposition an opportunity to say. I mean, we've discussed this an hour and a half from the positive perspective. Chairman, that's all I have to say. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Smedley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Mr. Mayor, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I do have a question for you. You said that you have been meeting with different folks on this issue that you trust, that are experts. How long have you been vetting this issue?
Thank you, Commissioner Smedley, for that question. Actually, I think y'all actually came into my office second week in December. Of course, the commission only met, I think, adjourned on the 18th and met last week. So, I mean, there wasn't any, and I don't know that there was going to be a need for any presentation, but I've just met the one time with the bridge group, and then after that, I've reached out to some people that were attorneys and some people that were to get additional information about the rules and that go along with it, such as what I asked today. And it took a long time. And I think, you know, it's kind of been a little bit of a moving target because, you know, the question that I posed is, well, it's not that they can't, that there's refugees. People think that if we don't sign a letter, the refugees won't come here. It just means that if they want to come here and they got family or an organization like Bridge won't get the money, but they still can come here. I mean, and I think there's a, you know, kind of a misnomer out there that people believe that, you know, that there won't be any refugees if we don't sign a letter. That's not true. People are still going to come here. I mean, you're just not going to know that, you know, wherever they came in is going to have the information about them, as well as the funding is going to go wherever they came, wherever they entered the system here. So, I mean, I hear what everybody's saying about lack of information, but, you know, this is not new. I mean, it's been, people have been coming in for decades. The only thing that's new is that President Trump has said that the governor and the executive of the locale has to sign this letter. And so, I mean, if, you know, I appreciate what Commissioner Baker said. I mean, you always want to hear from the opposition and the things that you hear. And a lot of it is, you know, the misinformation of the confusion between what these refugees that have been vetted are coming here as opposed to what an illegal immigrant coming here. I mean, you know, those are the only meetings that I've had, been mostly by telephone, and then the one meeting in my office of being able to consult with people that are, you know, that are more up on the topic. And what I've found, the more people I talk to, the more opinions you get about what actually the law says, or the executive order says. And like you said, then when we saw they were, you know, postponing the deadline, I mean, the real deadline, actually, I mean, what I was told, May 21st is the funding deadline. You know, the decision can go as far as May, but if you wait till May, then there won't be any funding that comes. You could sign a letter, they could come here, but there wouldn't be any additional funding. You can correct me if I'm wrong about that. That was my latest update.
Mayor Coppinger, when you say that people will still come, it sounds like we're not losing anything. People will still come. We're not closing the doors on refugees. From my perspective, what we're losing is giving them a foundation for success. Coming through the agency, social service agency, was trained experts in resettlement of refugees per se, gives people a little bit head up in their success. We are the agency that will provide them with connections with faith-based communities, right, volunteers, employers who are seeking
Mr. Mayor,
you know, we are losing the whole scope of services that would.
So I don't mean to interrupt you, but I know people are getting restless here. My question to you then is this. But my question is this. Your organization is for, you know, is your main purpose is for resettlement, right?
Right.
So you would resettle somebody if they approached you from Knoxville without the money, I would hope. I mean, your goal is to make sure these people are looked after, whatever. I hope it's not just about getting the federal dollars, is it?
We provide employment services for up to 5 years to people who come with the refugee status.
But my question is if someone came here and they didn't, and they were resettling here from, let's say, California, they came here and they contacted your organization, you're still going to work with them, right? You just don't get the federal dollars.
Right.
Right. Okay. So I just want to make sure that, I mean, because I know, because we met, and I know, sure, I know you're in it for all the right reasons. I mean, I just want everybody to know this. I know you're in it for the right reasons, but I want to just want to make sure, because this commission's asking some of the really tough questions I had to begin with. But my point was, is exactly, it does not mean that they can't or won't come here. It's just about the dollars. And I would think that our community, if they're going to come here, would want the federal dollars to come with them.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I mean, I think we're on the same page. I'm just saying that
it's not just money. It's also technical support,
right,
that we receive. All the information, all the trainings, webinars, everything. You know, it's a huge network that, yeah, we have access to. Database of cultural orientations, you know, answers to difficult questions, how to work with people who have trauma,
and language training,
and language,
for both generations,
yeah. It's money and technical support that we would like to have from the federal
Mayor
government.
Mayor Coffer, I think you were asking a really good question
about
January 21st versus May.
Yeah.
I think where
Mr.
Rain might help is
Mr.
Just to say what might to her disadvantage.
Come over to me.
Would something work to her disadvantage between January 21st and the May flow of dollars?
On the 21st, our proposal will be submitted to State Department. Every proposal has to have certain documentation attached to it. And I was asked, I wrote my proposal. I collected numbers. I have to have your consent to apply. Now,
again,
nobody will tell me that I cannot apply, but the chances minimizes, as you correctly mentioned, with, you know, probably more proposals with the decrease of numbers and agencies that will be in the game for this money.
Mr. Chairman, follow up question.
I'm not finished.
Well, let me finish that thought. Again, the only reason I brought up the 21st of May, I mean, January versus May is time sensitive because,
right,
but people will, you know, say, well, you've got till May, really, if, you know, we really don't have till May, although it's going to appear.
Right.
I mean,
if
to get the funding, it has to be next week.
Mr. Mayor, I'm not sure if I need to ask you or
Marina.
Yeah, Marie, but I just want a quick answer.
Yes.
If you sign it by the end of the month, is that acceptable? I know there's a deadline, the 21st, but let's say the 21st comes and goes and you haven't signed it and you decide to sign it at the end of the month, what happens?
I'm not sure. You may know, but I've...
See, there's so many unanswered
questions. My understanding is that the funding has to be in place by the 21st. I mean, she has to submit a budget.
So we go with the guidelines and deadlines that we're given, and it's 21st.
Yeah, well, I'm hearing your conversation back and forth with them, and it sounds like there's even new information coming forth today. I haven't had time. I don't know if I'm for or against this, and I don't know what District 7 feels. And that's first and foremost, is I do not know how my constituents feel. And I appreciate Mr. Frierson for sharing all the information. Appreciate you being here today, and appreciate you saying you wish it had not come as a surprise. But unfortunately, it's a big surprise. And I haven't had an opportunity to vet it, didn't even know it was incumbent upon us to do so, because I thought it was not even an issue for this body. So with the mayor needing to sign it, you know, we often get criticized, and I hope you understand this. We often get criticized in making very quick decisions, and if you come to a commission meeting, there's little discussion. They just, you know, make quick votes, and we all know that there's a lot of work behind the scenes and that we all try to do our due diligence and our homework, but I haven't had that opportunity. So for the record, I'm going to have to abstain on the vote, but I don't know if I'm for or against. I don't know what my constituents
are for or against, and that's very important to me. That's all. That's all. Thank you.
Let me remind the commission, and I hear all the feelings that's going on. Let me remind the commission, we're not voting. This vote would only be a, hey, attaboy, mayor, go with it. It's not a, we're not voting to do it or not to do it. I think it would sound like the words used was it's a cover, you know, so I wanted to remind there one more light's on, Commissioner Sharp, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Chairman. Back to the whole, you know, miscommunication, false narrative, idea, you know, multiple times have been said today, we're talking about immigrants, but we're not talking about immigrants. We're talking about refugees, right? And we're talking about accepting, what the mayor's having to face here is an issue where he has been extended an offer by the President of the United States to accept a no-match grant, which we do on this body every week almost. We're happy to accept a no-match grant to aid in the assistance of the resettlement of individuals who are thoroughly vetted by the Trump administration to live here in our communities and contribute to society here locally. So that's all it's about. Match-free grant that our mayor can accept or not accept. And he seemed to be struggling with it. I thought it made sense to offer him a bit of support. So that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Hold your breath. I don't see any more lights on. I haven't made a comment. The only comment I think I will make is the choice is the mayor's. And so I'm deferring to the mayor to have him make that choice. So do we have a motion and a second?
Dr. Mackey, second. Commissioner Sharp.
Okay.
And you want Kerry to read what was stated?
I really do. That was an hour and 45 minutes ago, so let's read it. Okay, he'll restate it. Dr. Mackey, restate it. Oh my goodness.
Peanuts and Coke.
Barbara Mandrell.
The motion I put forward was to, the intent was to get the commission on the record saying we supported the mayor writing the letter. So however Mr. Knowles want to word that is going to be okay with me. Thank you.
I've talked to the attorney. He will prepare a resolution. That will be resolution 120-26, and we'll submit that to you after you take action and he does his part.
And Mr. Chairman, just to correct Commissioner Mackey, if you're wrong, it's to encourage the mayor.
Exactly.
Because we haven't heard the mayor actually give his
That's correct.
Feelings, but it's to encourage the mayor to support the program.
Okay.
That's correct.
To give encouragement. Okay. We have a motion. Is your second stay in place?
Yes.
Okay. You've got the motion. You've got some feedback. You've got the motion, and then you've got the second.
Right.
We're ready to vote. Okay.
Commissioner Baker. Commissioner Maxson.
Before I vote, I am going to make one short statement because I have had separate meetings with some refugees and I know a little bit more about it, so I'm going to support it. Yes.
Why didn't you let us know?
Commissioner Banks and I. Commissioner Boyd. Commissioner Jeter.
Yes.
Dr. Mackey.
Yes.
Commissioner Martin.
Abstain.
Commissioner Sharp.
Yes.
Commissioner Smedley.
Abstain.
Mr. Chairman.
And I'm going to abstain.
Do we have to call them again? Okay. 4-3 and 2 absences.
So let me reiterate. We said that resolution did not pass. So what that says was a resolution was not passed to encourage the mayor to participate. So because, and the reason I'm trying to be so exact about that, I don't want a story written that says the commission voted down this program. I'm just trying to be as plain as I can be. I don't want the headlines to say the county commission voted down this program. So that isn't the case. I've got a light on. Commissioner Smedley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to say Commissioner Bangston mentioned he had met with some constituents. I did hear from a student at Southern Adventist that actually came and met with me in my office, but the concern from what I took from that meeting was the concern was more geared towards the limitations that the Trump administration had put on the number of refugees that were being accepted. So from that, I didn't get a lot of information, but I just wanted to say that because that student did take the time to come and meet with me. Thank you.
So, and for the record, everybody's going on the record, I hadn't heard from anyone. So today's the first day I've heard about the program, so no one came and talked to me, so I didn't hear. Mr. Attorney, do you have any announcements? Mr. Mayor, do you have any announcements?
Yes, thank you. State Senator Bo Watson asked for me to announced today so the public will be aware that the General Assembly at the state level has reconvened. And so if you got any issues to do that, and again, I just want to say thank you to all the people that are participating, including the commission today, about the decision that's going to be made here in the next week. And so I appreciate you.
Okay, thank you. The only announcement I had was a letter here from Senator Watson, telling the public they were back in the meeting, so apparently he told us both he got it covered. So and he did also say in the letter, videos for all floor sessions and committee hearings can be accessed on www.capitaltn.gov. So that gives you a website if you want to go on and see what they're doing up there in the state legislature. Okay, let's does anyone have anything to bring before this commission other than zoning? If not, I'd like to, somebody start to clap. I would like to remind you that we will not be next week because there's 5 weeks in this month and we're only allowed to meet 4. So if no one else has any other business, we will be in recess until January the 29th at 9:30.